But now get to progressivism. Which I entitled Progressivism and the Triple Alliance, Government as Cartelizer. And just as I believe, of course, I mentioned like last night that I don't believe that big business monopoly, in quotes, grew up out of the free market. Government had to combat it. Quite the contrary, business was doing very well on its own, with monopoly collapsing and big business being very progressive in this, in the correct sense. And now we have a new system being imposed upon it, the progressive era, with the government functioning as giant cartelizer. And the reason I consider the progressive period very important is I think really the progressive period is us. You know, like we are the enemy. We met the enemy and we are us. The famous joke. We're living in the progressive period. Really, we're living in a more systematic, more developed form of it. But really, the embryo of all the stuff that we're living in, all the regulatory agencies and social welfare and all the rest of it, including war mobilization, really starts in the progressive period and continues on, sort of grows and strengthens and develops in sort of a cancerous growth. This, of course, is a very value-free discussion. and it proliferates and so forth. And the problems that we call this system? I don't know. There's all sorts of names for it. I sort of vacillate here and there between what to call it. It's been called the middle way or the third way. I can call it state monopoly capitalism, you can call it state capitalism, you can call it the corporate state, progressivism, the mixed economy, the welfare warfare state, new nationalism, new freedom, deal, fair deal, great society. But I like the word corporate state, I think it's a certain good ring to it. It also fits in very nicely with, of course, the Stato Cooperativo in Italy in the 20s, 30s. And also, some other phrases, the military, educational, industrial complex, the garrison state, so forth and so on. Neomercantilism is all sorts of ways you can look at it. What you do then, essentially, not only cartelize, but you replace these disorderly, in quotes, functions of the market of voluntary action by a strong central government, big government, the phrase, headed usually by a strong leader, known as President of the United States, Duce in Italy, and Führer in Germany. All of these are terms for leaders, purely Wertfrei analysis. And you have a strong government staff by all sorts of great experts and technicians, recruited from the new intellectuals and professional intellectuals who've been proliferating, as we mentioned before, to plan the economy, to subsidize it, regulate it, push people around, tell them what to do, tell them not to eat vitamins or to eat vitamins or whatever. All sorts of great functions they perform. In conjunction with who? Which is the Triple Alliance? Triple Alliance, in my view, is the various segments of big business interests, those who couldn't make the monopoly on the market. Progressive intellectuals who were looking for the status, privileges, and the moolah that goes with the state apparatus. And the junior partner created by the whole system, new labor unionism, or so-called responsible labor unionism, symbolized by the AFL-CIO, certainly by the AFL. They might have some arguments about the CIO. At any rate, to impose then this system under the guise, as I mentioned before, of anti-monopoly, you know, the guise of welfare, of humanism, et cetera, the common good, the public interest, general welfare, so forth. Incidentally, about mercantilism, it's always bemused me about mercantilism, since I really believe this is a recrudescence of mercantilism in the industrial era. It's amusing about mercantilism that people, many economists looking at mercantilism say, well, yeah, it's irrational. Because you look at it and they say, here are these guys, they're subsidizing exports and they're also subsidizing imports. They're claiming we have to have greater exports, they're pushing exports, yet they don't want to buy things from abroad. This is crazy. And I have all sorts of classical economic analyses showing the idiocy of mercantilism and so forth and so on. The problem with that is it's only irrational from the point of view of logic or economic theory or the consumer. It's not irrational from the point of view of the guys who are getting subsidized, the guys who are making it in the system, who are the export industries who are being subsidized and the import, the domestic industries who are being protected by the tariff. So you have a joint alliance, so to speak, of the export interests and the domestic interests, both of whom are being subsidized by the system, at the expense of the lowly consumer and taxpayer. You know, it's the same thing with the New Deal farm program, which, I'm leaping ahead, but it's a beautiful example of so-called irrationality in action. You have a farm program which starts with Herbert Hoover in March 1929 and continues on through Roosevelt, of course, and from then on. If you look at the farm program from the point of view of rationality, it seems like total lunacy. Here you have a situation where, for example, the government is paying farmers not to produce wheat or cotton, paying them to produce less or produce nothing and have a soil bank and let it lie fallow, etc., paying them to restrict production. At the very same time, another division of the Department of Agriculture down the hall is paying them money to irrigate, to subsidize them, to have them new agricultural machinery and new irrigation, new fertilizer techniques, paying them to produce more. Now, this looks like economic insanity. On one hand, you have the Department of Agriculture, one division, paying farmers to produce less wheat. On the other hand, you have another division paying them to produce more wheat. Sounds crazy, right? It's not crazy. It's not crazy from two points of view. It's not crazy from the point of view of the Department of Agriculture, which now has two huge division bureaucratic divisions, happily, either paying money for this, the contradictory thing, and for the farmers, who get paid both ways, of course. Get paid not to produce less and get paid to produce more. They're raking it in. It's fantastic. I wish I could be paid to teach more and to teach less. So for the farmers, usually, of course, the big farmers, that's a real bonanza. For the taxpayer and the consumer, of course, it is irrational. Folks. Yeah. Senator Eastland, he's pretty for a motor company. Okay, I don't know. Yeah, great. What are they being paid not to produce? Wheat or cotton? That's great. as I pointed out, they had to replace the mercantilist, the old mercantilist, by the way. So I mentioned recommend the Edgar Furness book on mercantilism. The old mercantilists were very frank. One of the things about the old mercantilism, they didn't have to worry about elections, about the votes, about PR and that sort of stuff, Madison Avenue techniques. They laid it on the line. And their view of the masses, the English working masses, for example, was very frank. For example, William Pettit, distinguished mercantilist, wrote of labor as, quote, a capital material, raw and undigested, committed into the hands of supreme authority, in whose prudence and disposition it is to improve, manage, and fashion it to more or less advantage. That's the more or less advantage of the ruling groups. So there's no problem about common good, general welfare, and that sort of stuff. None of that nonsense in the mercantilist period. But now we have a situation. We have democracy or voting. We have classical liberalism, which one of the great pitches of classical liberalism was that it would bring prosperity and increase the standard of living, etc., of everybody. So now you had to appeal to the masses for this new rhetoric. It appealed to them as really more humanitarian, more general welfare-y, if that's a word, than laissez-faire. But you need, as I say, you need two things. You need liberal intellectuals, court intellectuals, to propound the virtues of the system, to weave apologetics for it, and you need responsible labor unions to keep the workers in line in case they get a little feisty. Fortunately, they had a model. Both groups really had a model. I think we've touched on this before, which is essentially Bismarck's Germany, Prussia and Germany in the late 19th century. First of all, Bismarck pioneered state cartelization, the idea of the state forcing industries into cartels and restricting production and raising prices. When they did that, and buying the masses off with social welfare programs, with social insurance of all sorts, unemployment insurance, health insurance, and the rest of it. Not only buying them off, but also cartelizing, because when you raise the cost, I mentioned before, of all firms in the industry, you cartelize. You enable them. You enable them to raise prices on top of it. Please, afterward. Huh? Yeah. Corporate was a little later. And then to protect this, to ensure that Germany, of course, is not going to be outcompeted if you're raising the prices and restricting production of the German industrial machine, to protect them against foreign competition, you have to have very high tariffs to insulate the German industry from the foreign competition, which you had under the Bismarck system. So the protective tariff becomes extremely important to the German cartel system. So it's all linked together. As I say, you have the original welfare state program, which by, again, by the pointing out, by increasing business costs, necessitated the cartelization and helped along with the cartelization. Also along with this came the pro-union policy, building up responsible labor unions in Germany, also raising costs for everybody and allowing this kind of cartelization to take place. All of the expense, of course, of the German consumer who was unorganized. And as I pointed out, the second method of doing this, the way the liberal movement, which is very Laissez-Faire liberal movement, which was quite strong in Germany at the time, the way that was smashed was by the patriotic military national front kind of thing, where Bismarck split the liberals in two. Hence, also, of course, using similar techniques later to split the socialists when the war came, the social democrats going along with the war effort, also part of the patriotic front. The core intellectuals were highly developed, as I mentioned before in the discussions. Gustav Schmoller, the great German historian and economist at the University of Berlin, declared the task of professors of the university to be, quote, the intellectual bodyguard of the House of Hohenzollern. I repeat that, and I think it's a beautiful, short summation. And we have a PhD-manship and all the rest. And we have the people influenced by German graduate school, as I pointed out. And another thing about the intellectuals at times, I also touched on, they rejected laissez-faire, these new progressive intellectuals, rejected laissez-faire for reasons I talked about yesterday, and rejected Marxism as being too messy, too revolutionary, too proletarian. After all, if you're really strictly proletarian, you haven't got much room for bourgeois intellectuals. I mean, you have to really shuffle the cards a lot. You have to adopt the Karl Mannheim thesis that, well, it's okay for it to be an intellectual, even though you're not a worker, because the intellectuals are free-floating. They're above class determination. They somehow rise above. They float above. They levitate above the class struggle. But that's really kind of, you know, it's kind of chancy. So if you're a bourgeois intellectual, Marxism looks pretty messy. And so here we find this third way, this way of the national state apparatus, etc. And we find this fortuitous coincidence, so to speak, of these new intellectuals coming up, influenced by German cartelizing ideas, welfare state ideas, and we find businessmen also aiming in this direction. We have this happy fusion of these two groups. Happy fusion of intellectuals seeking a state and the businessmen seeking intellectuals. We have this marvelous coming together of these two groups. Also, in addition to that, to have a state apparatus, you have to have technicians. You have to have people actually planning. You have to have intellectuals staffing the bureaus and planning the economy and giving money to the poor and all that stuff. See, you need a lot of intellectuals to do this. And so you need experts or technicians. You begin to have the idea, which of course permeates the progressive period and later on. You don't hear it so much anymore. Maybe just in the last few years, it happily has died out a bit. But the idea is you need experts. And the key thing you have, politics is messy. This, as we'll see in a little later, permeates the urban progressivism, municipal progressivism, too. Politics is very messy. You know, it's corrupt, and people buying votes, and it's chancy, and so on and so on. But we need to replace all this messy political conflict with experts. Experts who levitate above the political struggle, who take things out of politics. This, of course, we hear this all the time. If there's a problem in the New York subway system or something, take it out of politics. Remove it from the post office. Take it out of politics. But it actually means, of course, it's still under government hands, except now you can't vote about it. You can't even vote to do anything about it. You can't get rid of it. It's there as a permanent carbuncle on the system. Isolate it, insulate it for any kind of political action. I'm no fan of politics, but the one good thing about politics is at least the voter can have some kind of influence getting rid of the thing. But now this is eliminated. You say, take it out of politics, put it into the hands of the experts, who turn out to be these progressive types, technicians, etc., etc. And so this, the new intellectual, the progressive intellectual, are push this very hard. The idea of taking things out of politics, taking foreign policy out of politics, bipartisanship, take the streets out of politics, take a post office out of politics, and pretty soon, of course, there's nothing to vote about except which gang of clowns is going to do this. So all the issues are taken out of the public hands. So this becomes, I say, a continuing theme among all these new intellectuals. But incidentally, Coco's Triumph of Conservatism, which I think is an excellent book. The one criticism that my old friend Marty Sklar, who's a distinguished, rather erratic New Left historian, Marty Sklar's one criticism of the Coco book was the title. He said instead of being the Triumph of Conservatism, it should have been the Triumph of Liberalism, and which sort of highlights the fact there's not really too much difference between conservatism and liberalism when you get right down to it. And certainly, I think he's right. I think the term corporate liberal is a beautiful, essentially a Williams term, is a beautiful term for the intellectuals and the businessmen who are pushing major theoreticians or even minor theoreticians for this corporate state kind of system. I mentioned the Needham quote about Witfold, so I won't repeat that, about the glory of the ancient China, you know, making poets and scholars into officials. Oh, here's the quote. Needham says, quote, "The successive Chinese emperors were served in all ages by a great company of profoundly humane and disinterested scholars." I love that. Beautiful word. And he says, "The civilization which Professor Wittfogel was so bitterly attacking was one which could make poets or scholars into officials." Okay. The intellectual, the planner, etc., the expert, the technician, becomes another great term, beautiful term, which probably comes in this period, maybe later, the social engineer. It's a really beautiful term also. He's a technician, he's an engineer planning people, you know, shuffling around like the regular engineer, the non-social engineer is, you know, shuffling stones around or shuffling levers or electricity. The social engineer shuffles around people. This sort of brings me, I'm really leaping ahead a lot, but it brings me to one of my, use the term that Professor Rico likes to use, in my second, just about my second favorite person. Now, my first favorite person would be, you know, some Charles Manson or Dick Spock or whatever his name is, Speck, Richard Speck. Second favorite person of the my second favorite person of the 20th century is Rexford Guy Tugwell. sort of embodies an enormous amount of this stuff. And one of the great social engineers. When I was entered the right wing, so to speak, they were always quoting this great poem by Tugwell. I wish I had brought it up with me. I'm sure you've all seen it. But it goes something like, "I shall," he Tugwell, speaking, of course, for his class, so to speak, "I shall roll up my sleeves, I shall gather my charts and my compasses, I shall roll up my sleeves, I shall make America over." That really grabs you in the gut. And so it's Tugwell and his fellow social engineers, his fellow technocrats, as they're also called, rolling up their sleeves and making everybody over, which is really, of course, what it amounts to. So this, of course, is a heady line for the new intellectuals. I mean, here, my goodness, before this, what could they do? They could be ministers teaching, you know, humane or moral philosophy and some small college somewhere. Here they're making America over. I mean, it's this really heady line for, if you wonder why intellectuals tend to be status, I think there's right there. Now, James Gilbert has written a very interesting book, just come out about 6 months ago, called Designing the Industrial State, which I've also mentioned in my bibliography, where he deals largely with these progressive intellectuals and their so-called collectivism. And he shows that the collectivism ranges from what we call left to what we call right, from industrial people to socialists and so forth. It really doesn't make much difference. I mean, they're saying almost the same things. When he talks about the collectivist intellectuals, Gilbert says that what they were engaged in was, quote, "the effort to make room for themselves and to mark off a function which would be their own specialty and justification." Well, this is, you know, economic determinism of the intellectuals, so to speak. Many of these people found that the kind of the corporation, kind of the structure of the corporation was their model, except they wanted to make it compulsory and universal. Charles Steinmetz, the famous engineer working for General Electric, felt that the whole world should be one vast General Electric, constituting the government, sort of the government as General Electric or vice versa. And there were many other people who had very similar views in this period. So we have these experts. We have, I think, I have a note here that a certain Tolman, 1909, first used the phrase social engineers. It might have been earlier. We have the economists changing. We have the new science of sociology, in quotes, popping up with very similar views and so forth and so on. So to the collectivist intellectuals, there would be the intellectuals, these intellectuals would form these social engineers. They form these experts. They form this cast of technicians, technocrats, destined to harmonize all classes. See, they're above the classes. You have the idea also that the state is being the umpire of everything, but they after all can see clearly and deeply. Being big shot intellectuals, they can roll up their sleeves and make us all over. And they can harmonize big business and big labor and all other groups in this one great, you know, harmonic, hierarchical kind of structure. And as social scientists, is another thing. The idea of social science as giving you the right and the license and the privilege to mold everybody also, of course, comes in as part of this whole picture. Because you have scientific social engineering. It's not just your values. It's not just the Tugwell is trying to tell us what to do because he's an SOB. It's because he's a scientist. He sees deeply and more clearly than the rest of us, and therefore he pushes us around. And they were above politics. We shouldn't even consider them tarred with a political brush and subject to voting at the election, because they should be a permanent part of the American structure. So, as Gilbert puts it, I think it was very neatly, quote, occupying a position above the dialectic of social struggle, they felt able to judge the aspirations of the other classes. So they're levitating up there as free-floating intellectuals. And we have many of these people are kind of fascinating. It could be a whole bunch of studies devoted. There are studies devoted to these people, and they need more study. So the idea of the scientific expert, the efficiency expert, etc., fitting in as planner and organizer and theoretician. Forrest mentioned John Cummins. John R. Cummins is one of the key people in this whole effort. Very interesting figure. First of all, he was a student of Richard T. Ely, who's one of the guys who was influenced by Germany. One of the first anti-laissez-faire Americans, who gets his PhD in Germany, comes back with this new message of, you know, the new welfare state kind of system. Cummins is a devoted student of Ely, Johns Hopkins, follows Ely to Wisconsin, becomes the founder or one of the co-founders of the so-called Wisconsin idea, which now permeates progressivism from then on. Wisconsin idea formulating all sorts of stuff, unemployment insurance, social security, the whole stuff, all these things start in Wisconsin and then permeate outward, often with Cummins doing it himself. Extremely influential with the AFL, because his whole theory of labor unions is essentially the AFL theory, you know, erected into a quote science. The idea that you have labor unions carving out monopoly systems areas, usually craft unions, which of course is the AFL thing. Keeping out lower types, because it was one of the things about the things that gives craft unions union power. Power to raise wage rates, you're keeping out low types being the unskilled, minority races, and so forth and so on. So we have this thing all enters the AFL thesis. Cummins being one of the great ideologists, not an ideologist, but activist, working up legislation of all sorts in Wisconsin and the federal government and so forth. Cummins was a distinguished corporatist. In 1899, Cummins delivers a paper before the American Economic Association and sets forth his thesis in some detail. He says the Congress, we shouldn't have this political Congress. Note the intimations trailing clouds of glory of fascism later on. Congress should not be messy and have voters from geographical districts. Congress should consist of representatives of organized economic classes. Labor unions should elect their representatives. And bankers like J.P. Morgan, whom he mentioned specifically, by the way, me being a Morgan diabolist, I think is very interesting, should elect their representatives, and the trusts should elect their representatives, all in favor of trusts. And the railroads are like their representatives, the farm blocks are like their representatives, and then we all band together with economists electing their representatives. That's a really cute one. I find that a special personal grabber. Economists are like their representative. Mitch Ely, of course, is one of the people who should be the first, you know, guy to be elected by economists. Obviously, the implicit thing is that he would be the second. And with economists running this whole show, running Congress, this new, you know, Congress of American Occupations, whatever they call it, we then have broad, quote, broad-minded patriotic compromises, unquote, between all these groups engineered by the economists. Boy, that's... I'm sure the economists in the room would be particularly happy with this arrangement. And again, he keeps on with this. In 1908, he talks about three major groups in society, workers, capitalists, and the, quote, public. And then, again, he's one of the founders of this whole theory of the tripartite commission. Tripartite organization running everything, running specific things and everything. You have the representative of unions, you have the representative of capitalists, and you have the representative of the so-called public. It always turns out to be somebody like Commons, some guy like that, and they run everything. And they represent, this so-called public representative represents the nation, society, and science, all wrapped up in one big, great ball of wax. The workers and the capitalists are narrow self-interested. It's okay. It wasn't against self-interest, but they were narrow. They like their representatives, and along with them, harmonizing and, you know, running the whole show, well, as the scientific sociologist and economist. So the public and these tripartite kind of bureaus and commissions and regulatory agencies are supposed to be embodied in progressive intellectuals, manning the state and its allied institutions as experts, officials, scientists, academics, reformers, government agents, mediation boards, lawyers, etc., etc. This whole group, proliferation of new professionals coming up. And as I said, these intellectuals were the public, in quotes, because they floated high above the narrow, selfish economic interests of these narrower economic classes. As Gilbert says, quote, in the frozen dialectics of such a state, the intelligentsia, but being them, and the technical experts seem to be the national rulers. Then you have this whole idea of society as an organism. All this comes up around this, begins to proliferate this stuff. Society as an organism, society as a giant machine. For example, one of the collectivist intellectuals says, quote, at this time, society, quote, society is a colossal machine of which we are all parts, and men in the most exact sense are members one of another. But of course, you know, there's somebody heading the machine, and that guy is the, you know, the Rex Tugwell type, is the social engineer, the social mechanic, if you want to call it. And every one of the social organism kind of metaphor is always a brain or a head of the social organism. Therefore, you have to have a, you know, every really developed organism has a brain, and the head of the brain, of course, is the state apparatus, the government, and these guys staffing it. And Steinmetz, whom I mentioned, was a great inventor, of course, advocated a, quote, powerful centralized government of deeply competent men remaining continuously in office, unquote. his book in 1916. Now, obviously, see, this is one of the criticisms of socialism later on becomes, well, you know, you have this great national plan. Here's the socialist government's developing its five-year plan, and it's all set. You can't have somebody mucking around with it. You know, like 6 months from now, you have an election, they throw out the plan. It's impossible. You have to have continuity. And, of course, the way you have continuity of all this is not have elections at all, or else have piddling elections for the, you know, Bolshevik self-criticism at the very low level, you know, some local level where you throw out one, you know, sub-foreman. And this theme also begins, of course, to permeate literature. Now, the alliance... Being a conspiracy theorist and a Morgan Diabolist, I can't resist this. Herbert Crowley, who was one of the great, of course everybody I think knows about, but he's one of the great theoreticians of the Teddy Roosevelt's new nationalism, and very much in the spirit, a progressive and a collectivist intellectual, was set up, earned his niche in life, received his niche in life as editor of a great new weekly journal, which we all love and revere, The New Republic. And he lucubrates and infuses from then on. In the late 20s, as we'll see later, he becomes a great laudator, theoretician for Mussolini's fascism. And for good reason, because it all fits into this kind of setup. The thing I want to point out is that the magazine New Republic was owned and established by Willard Strait, Morgan Partner. His son Michael Strait, or grandson, whatever it was, continued on until very recently as the publisher, owner of the New Republic. I don't see coincidences in all this. Okay, we come now to the couple of the organizations of the corporatists. One of the major organizations my old friend James Weinstein has developed and examined in his book, Corporate Ideal in the Liberal State. Notice he calls it the liberal state rather than the conservative state, following along with the Sklar analysis. The National Civic Federation. The National Civic Federation is extremely important. It dies out in the 20s, largely because the brilliant organizer of this thing, a certain Ralph Easley, becomes a real hopped-up red-baiter by the 20s. He becomes so extreme that they all sort of leave him, and the organization dies out. But before the war, before World War I, it's founded in 1900, before the war and during the war, it's the major organization we can call corporate liberalism. It pushes, inaugurates all the great welfare programs, unemployment insurance, various social welfare, monopolistic, the Federal Trade Commission, et cetera, as we develop. National Civic Federation consists of many, all sorts of big shots. The roster reads like a litany of big shots at the time. All sorts of big businessmen, all sorts of trade union, responsible trade union leaders. Gompers, of course, being very high on the list, head of the American Federation of Labor. And public representatives, including corporate lawyers, university presidents, newspaper publishers, etc. And they had, the National Civic Federation had state councils, state federations, which would handle, you know, handle problems at district level and so forth. The first president of the National Civic Federation was Marcus Hanna, the famous boss of the Republican Party for many years, the Ohio Republican machine. He leaves fairly quickly. He's replaced by August Belmont, an international banker extraordinaire from New York. And the rest of the roster of the group organization, as I say, includes an enormous number of big shots, several Morgan partners, of course, including George W. Perkins, who will pop up again and again in these lectures, and Judge Gary and Henry W. Davison is a Morgan partner, and Isaac Seligman is a banker, and Andrew Carnegie, Charles Francis Adams, the National City Bank, Cyrus McCormick, and on and on. Jacob Riis, John R. Cummins, of course. These guys, of course, are very, very strong in this whole business. And also other big shots. William Howard Taft, Grover Cleveland in his late declining years. Elihu Root, who's everywhere, ubiquitous in the corporate and political structure, Morgan-oriented. Nicholas Murray Butler, my revered, for whom I am named, revered president of Columbia University. Charles Eliot, the Harvard Eliot, and so forth. George W. Perkins, by the way, in addition to being a Morgan partner, is also director of United States Steel and International Harvester. Some strange coincidence, because the Morgans put them all together. He was also wound up as the operating head of the Progressive Party of America, which is devoted to bringing freedom and prosperity and public interest to all of us. George W. Perkins noted, for example, that businessmen should be and are, fortunately for him, you know, it's both a value statement and an existential statement, businessmen should be and are merging, quote, into the public officialdom, or into public officials. What's now known as the partnership of government and industry begins to, of course, develop in this period. Many of the National Civic Federation was stronger, apparently, on the bankers than they were on the industrialists, if you want to weight these things. Henry Ford certainly was very much opposed to this group, and various others. And Ralph Easley put it beautifully. It's one of the great statements, one of the great sentences in the Weinstein book. Our enemies, that means the enemies of the National Federation consensus, this great centrist consensus, state monopoly capitalist consensus which is developing. Our enemies are the socialists among the labor people, that means the left wing, Marxist socialist, among the labor people, and the anarchists among the capitalists, unquote. By the anarchists among the capitalists, he meant essentially the National Association of Manufacturers, which in those days represented largely small business and were anti-union and generally laissez-faire, roughly laissez-faire outlook. I'm not going to push that, but roughly. And they were, of course, called anarchists by the new corporate state theoreticians. One of the things they were pushing quite early was the welfare state kind of setup, early welfare state setup. And also they were pushing unionism. This is part of this whole triple entente or triple alliance, was the idea of raising up unions as an important, a responsible part of this triple partnership, a junior partnership in this triple alliance. This is a lot. This is something for us that many businessmen could not swallow. I mean, having born and bred anti-unionism, it was very difficult for them, many of them, to accept the idea of suddenly welcoming the AFL into the picture. But the National Civic Federation definitely did. One of the things which the National Civic Federation developed was the idea that various issues of all sorts should, quote, be taken out of politics, unquote, and handled by experts non-politically. And one of the things they were pushing is that all problems are really technical, resolved by extra, you know, extra political means, with the collaboration of business, unions, and government. One of the things they were pushing were uniform state laws on workmen's compensation before they got to the national scene, which they got to fairly quickly. In the early 1900s or so, they were pushing the idea of minimum wage laws, workmen's compensation laws, and public utility regulation, and outlawing of child labor. This is some of the early National Civic Federation doctrines. Why do these big businessmen like minimum wage laws? Well, for one thing, as I said, this is part of a cartelizing process. You're imposing higher costs on everybody, including many of your nasty, rascally competitors, like small southern firms, for example, pay lower wage rates. If you force their wage rates up, you're imposing higher costs on them much more severely than you're imposing higher costs on yourself. As a matter of fact, the national minimum wage law, just to sort of skip to the current period for a minute, one of the main law, who are the guys who are lobbying for constantly higher minimum wage rates? Well, obviously unions are, for very good economic reasons, because they're increasing their pay, even though at the expense of increasing the unemployment of marginal unskilled workers, they don't really care much about. The other guys who are lobbying, and theoreticians, liberal theoreticians of all sorts, and another group, interesting group, that are lobbying constantly for higher federal minimum wage rates, northern textile manufacturers from New York and New England, and printers, too, who being inefficient, high cost, worrying about the competition of southern low-cost plants, want to impose, since they know, of course, prevailing wages are usually lower in the South than they are here, for one reason, cost of living is lower in the South, they want to impose higher wage rates on their southern competitors, and this is the way they do it. They like to have a protective tariff. They love to have a high tariff wall at the Potomac and keep out southern products. It's still unconstitutional to do that. So this is the indirect route by which they do it, imposing higher costs on their southern competitors. So the minimum wage is not necessarily an anti-business proposal. It all depends which businesses, I think Forrest mentioned, it all depends which businesses are doing it and what their interests happen to be. And so the National Civic Federation, gets the model legislation written by people like Commons and others, and they push it, lobby for it, and so forth and so on. Workmen's compensation laws were another thing they were pushing. The common law had stated that the employee, if he suffers an accident, cannot receive compensation from an employer unless he's assumed a knowledgeable risk. This is part of a knowledgeable assumption of risk of the job. If he contributes to the negligence, if his supervisor's contributory negligence, he helped cause the accident, or if a fellow employee was really responsible, a fellow servant doctrine. What the labor unions wanted at the time was to have a new kind of employer liability laws which would weaken these defenses in the common law courts so they could collect, employees can collect for damages. And so labor unions in those days were opposed to workmen's compensation laws because they felt this would be a way out. And workmen's compensation laws, after all, being paid for off to the largest extent by the workers themselves, their paycheck. What they wanted was to have a free field and collect through the courts. So the National Civic Federation has an end run around this and a cunning end run around this by promoting workmen's compensation legislation. And some of the people who were pushing this fairly early, by 1911, for example, were August Belmont and other industrialists, George W. Perkins, Andrew Carnegie, Otis Elevator Company, and so forth, et cetera, et cetera. The Perkins said about this and many other things. One another quote from Perkins: cooperation in business, meaning cartels and all these other things, and the government intervention, government cartelization, is taking and should take the place of ruthless competition. We had many private business compensation plans being developed, and the smaller businesses didn't have the resources for voluntary plans, so the smaller businesses were sucked in, or induced, I should say, to go along with the idea of workmen's compensation laws. So even the NAM then came out in support of it, and organized businessmen, only a few, quote, narrow-minded, unquote, businessmen continue to oppose it. And so by 1911, we really have state workmen's compensation laws begin to sweep all the states. The National Civic Federation took up the drive in earnest by 1908 or 1909, including especially August Belmont, who was pushing it very heavily. And by 1909, they persuaded the AFL to remove their previous opposition. From then on, it was a little easy street. We also had another interesting group, which starts around this period. It starts around 1900 or so. The American Association of Labor Legislation, some of the one of my sort of little pet outfits. It consists of all these intellectuals, all these economists, corporatists, kind of economists, sociologists, social workers, etc., and all these big businessmen and a couple of union leaders. And they were pushing. They began to push sort of permanently. They were devoted permanently all during the teens and twenties. Social welfare legislation, minimum wage laws, compulsory unionization of all sorts, etc. And in 1911, as sort of a slight hitch developed, the New York State Workmen's Compensation Law was declared unconstitutional by the pesky courts. The courts were one of the last vestiges of true laissez-faire, not corporatist system. They hadn't been clued in yet, or they were sincere about it. And they declared this New York State Compensation Law unconstitutional because it deprived businessmen of property without due process. And this enraged Teddy Roosevelt, for example. And the Survey magazine, which is one of the leading magazines of progressive intellectuals, said, talking about this decision, which I think is rather cute, it would have been different if it had been made by big businessmen. The problem is, in other words, big businessmen would have approved workmen's compensation laws as the only problem. The problem was these reactionary, old-fashioned judges. But they said if we really had broad-gauge businessmen with responsibility for vast property interests on their shoulders, such as J.P. Morgan, Jacob Schiff, E.H. Gary, Andrew Carnegie, and John J. Hill, it would have been much better. I mean, they would have approved it. And the major critic of this Ives decision, which is what it was a case of Ives versus South Buffalo Railway Company, the major critic of this was Francis Lynn Stetson, who was a multi-time Morgan lawyer, who criticized the Ives decision bitterly and tried to get a federal compensation law into Congress. He submitted a brief to Congress to try to overturn the federal action, which it turned out it didn't need, because the New York legislature overturned this and amended the state constitution to make the workmen's compensation legal. When the FTC begins, the origins of the Federal Trade Commission, we start with a bill such as the Hepburn Bill, which introduced the Congress in 1908, which wasn't passed yet, but it was prefigured the greatness to come. Some of the leaders in that were Francis Lynn Stetson, Morgan lawyer, and Victor Morowitz, and Bill Beach mentioned as a distinguished Morgan railroad lawyer, a lawyer associated with Morgan-owned railroads. The Hepburn Bill, which is the predecessor of the Federal Trade Commission, was opposed by the National Association of Manufacturers, the Merchants Association of New York, and the Board of Trade of New York, but they didn't cut the ice that the Morgans cut. Frank Muncy made a revealing statement, Frank Muncy being a newspaper publisher, and the Morgan Embit, wrote a letter to Teddy Roosevelt in January 1912, sort of summing up the outlook of him and his colleagues. He said, quote, "It is the work of the state to think for the people and plan for the people, to teach them how to do, what to do, and to sustain them in the doing. I have some quotes here. I guess I'll end this lecture. There's more to go, of course, in the progressive period tomorrow night. But end this lecture with some quotations here from Coco's Triumph for Conservatives. And I apologize for repeating the quote, which you've already read, but I think it sort of highlights some of the stuff. Coco says the progressivism, progressive legislation, progressivism in general, was, quote, the result not of any impersonal mechanistic necessity, but of the conscious needs and decisions of specific men and institutions. He also says that progressivism is, quote, was, quote, a movement for the political rationalization of business and industrial conditions, quote. The regulation itself, quote, was invariably controlled by leaders of the regulated industry and directed toward ends they deemed acceptable or desirable. Unquote. One of the things about Coco, for example, one of the things which he brings to this is that almost everybody admits now. If you look at the Interstate Commerce Commission, if you look at the CAB, everybody says, well, they're controlled by the major firms in the industry. The CAB is controlled by the big four airlines. Even the most devoted adherents of these regulations agree to this. But what they say is, well, the problem was it's deteriorated. Back in the good old days, in the golden age when these regulations were first founded, such as 1900, 1912 period, then they were great. Then they were put in by, you know, by real liberal, progressive, general welfare types, and really anti-big business, but somehow it got corrupted somewhere along the line. There was a decline from this golden age, and these firms took over. The big railroads and the big airlines, whatever, took over. Well, what Coco points out is they didn't take over. They had already taken over from the very beginning. They wrote the legislation, they lobbied for it, and they loved it from the very beginning. So this casts a complete new light on this golden age myth of industrial regulation. Other people, of course, have done similar things. George W. Hilton for the ICC, Paul McAvoy for the ICC, and various other people. Or again, as Coco puts it, he calls this political capitalism, which is another good word. I should have added this to the other my litany of about 20 before. Consisted, quote, of the utilization of political outlets to attain conditions of stability, predictability, and security, to attain rationalization in the economy. I would call that cartelization, another little gutsier word for it, a little more precise word for the same thing. And the fact he says, and he talks about the Morgan and the iron and steel industry and all the rest of it being favorable to these things. He says the fact that an Alabama grocer might be opposed to some of these things is really not important, because the guys with the political influence and power were not the Alabama grocers, but the people who I've been mentioning. Because he says, quote, the group that supported it consistently were, quote, the men in the top echelons of finance and industry. In other words, the key power centers. Well, I think this is a good point to stop. I will continue on tomorrow night with more specifics and different specific industries and different specific laws, and hopefully also the local, the municipal progressive. Thank you. Okay, I'm now going to go into a little wider application of my Morgan Diabolism here. And explain why I differ with Forrest on the William Howard Taft question. I recognize, of course, that Taft had this sort of dumb legalism in his approach. I mean, it's the law and it has to be enforced. Sort of attitude. So it's a question of emphasis as to his approach. It seems to me that one of the key points of political history in this whole period goes something like this. John D. Rockefeller is an Ohio Republican. He's based in Cleveland. His whole operation is in Cleveland. And the Ohio Republican Party is essentially a Rockefeller party. I don't go quite as far as those muckrakers who say, you know, so-and-so parenthesis Morgan or so-and-so parenthesis Rockefeller. But there was a close symbiosis, let's say, between the Ohio Republican Party and Rockefeller and Standard Oil ambit. We realize the Ohio Republican Party was extremely important in this whole period. McKinley was an Ohio Republican. Mark Hanna was the political boss of the entire party, as well as Ohio, was an Ohio Republican. Warren Harding was an Ohio Republican, William Howard Taft was an Ohio Republican. So I look at this whole, at the McKinley, Taft, Harding, etc., is essentially in the Rockefeller ambit. A little bit more factual information here. In the McKinley administration, for example, McKinley, well, first of all, was highly indebted to Senator Hanna, the great boss of the whole party. One thing is McKinley had been saved from bankruptcy by Mark Hanna. He borrowed from Hanna heavily to get out of it. And Hanna was more or less his political boss, his mentor, theoretician, and whatever, manipulator, etc. Mark Hanna, turns out, this pops up quite a bit somehow in this whole thing. Mark Hanna turned out to have been an old high school classmate and close friend of John D. Rockefeller Sr. That's sort of coincidental kind of. It's the first of many coincidences along this line. Speaker of the House, extremely powerful speaker, who was sort of the boss, not like now, the speaker is sort of, you know, first among equals. Extremely powerful speaker during this period was Speaker Thomas Reed, who turns out to have been an old friend of Henry H. Rogers, who was in the Rockefeller ambit, one of the Rockefeller families I've mentioned before, the Flaglers, Rockefellers, I mean, Pratts, etc. One of those was the Rogerses. Tom Platt, who was the Republican boss of New York State, turned out to have been an old schoolmate of John D. Rockefeller Sr. at Owego High School, somewhere around here, somewhere. That's the other classmate somehow popping up. Senator Nelson W. Aldrich, whom Forrest mentioned this morning, also turns out to have been the father-in-law of John D. Rockefeller Jr. He was a kinsman, in other words, of Rockefeller family. Aldrich, this is another footnote on Aldrich. He entered the Senate in 1881 as a moderately well-off wholesale grocer, and died 30 years later of something like $12 million on his $8,000 salary, as Forrest mentioned. And McKinley is also an important Ohio Republican senator, Senator Joseph Foraker, who was on the payroll of Rockefeller, so the direct payroll. In the McKinley cabinet, there was Secretary of State John Sherman, who was an Ohio Republican. He can't exactly be called a Rockefeller person. He's an old-timer, but still he's an Ohio Republican, which means something. Secretary of Treasury Lyman J. Gage, who was very close the National City Bank, which was William Rockefeller, essentially, William Rockefeller, his ambit. Now, William Rockefeller was the brother of John D. Rockefeller, and it's true there were some certain splits there, but I figure, and for our purposes, we can sort of lump them together a bit. The ambassador to Great Britain under the McKinley administration was Joe Choate, was the attorney for Standard Oil Company in New Jersey. And so we have a certain heavy propensity. There are other people from other groups, too, in the McKinley cabinet, but basically the weight, it seems to me, is on the side of the Rockefeller interest. The Rockefellers did not want Teddy Roosevelt to be vice president in the McKinley administration. It was considered in the Morgan ambit, considered, I think, quite properly. And they wanted... But they were forced to accept, and I figured, well, I have to appease the Morgans a little bit. So McKinley gets the Republican nomination as the Rockefeller person, and Teddy Roosevelt gets the vice presidential nomination. And McKinley is assassinated, and Teddy Roosevelt suddenly pops up as president. When we get to Teddy Roosevelt, it seems to me we get to somebody who's extremely in the Morgan ambit. And the Northern Security case wraps up even the slight anomaly in there. First of all, he was sore at Rockefeller, too. I mean, he was sore because Rockefeller tried to block his vice presidential nomination. So there was a certain personal animosity that Teddy Roosevelt had for Rockefeller. But in addition to that, we have the first great booster of Teddy Roosevelt. Turns out to be our old pal who I'll be talking about constantly through these lectures, George W. Perkins, Morgan partner. Other people... We have an old friend of Teddy Roosevelt, Elihu Root, who's almost ubiquitous in this whole period, who's a Wall Street lawyer of Thomas Fortune Ryan, who you can consider as a from New York, who was more or less in the Morgan ambit, at least an ally in the Morgan ambit, who's become Secretary of War and the Secretary of State. It's very difficult to keep up with, and he's extremely important. Elihu Root, during this period, worked for Morgan, for example, to reorganize Equitable Life Insurance Company. And so we consider him, I think, pretty well in the Morgan ambit. He also was Morgan's agent for Chinese investments during this whole period, during part of this period. He becomes Secretary of State in 1905, and he appoints as Assistant Secretary of State Robert Bacon, who was an old friend of Teddy Roosevelt, who was also a Morgan partner. Now, you see, either are two interpretations of all this, it seems to me, as we're going along. Either that all these guys are picking the best men available, sort of out of a big hat. And somehow, by coincidence, all these Morgan types are picked in one administration, Rockefeller types are picked in another administration. It seems to me the statistical probabilities of this happening are almost zero. Or you can feel some more personal, direct connections, which that's the hypothesis I'm going on. Also, Postmaster General in the Teddy Roosevelt administration was a certain George Von L. Meyer, coming from the hailing from the old Colony Trust Company of Boston, essentially an agent of Morgan. Secretary of the Navy was Paul Morton from Equitable Life, which I've already talked about as being in the Morgan ambit. Herbert L. Satterley, Assistant Secretary of the Navy, turned out to be Morgan's son-in-law, so even closer to the Morgan orbit. And the handpicked successor, until something went wrong, to Teddy Roosevelt, Teddy Roosevelt's handpicked successor, before he selected Taft, was Elihu Root. And Elihu Root was very bitter at not having gotten it. Sometimes he felt he had deserved it. The Attorney General under Teddy Roosevelt, who launched whatever trust busting was undertaken, was Philander C. Knox, who was coming from Western Pennsylvania, was a Carnegie Steel lawyer, and who essentially Frick Mellon, of course, and we've heard about Frick being sort of allied to the Morgans in this period in the U.S. Steel situation, and so forth. So we have these things. Meantime, we have the Roosevelt administration, okay, and the Sherman Antitrust Act, as we know, had hardly been used at all during this whole period. It's sort of a dead letter. Incidentally, just before I get to that, forward to that. My view of the Antitrust Act, you say, well, if I'm saying that the corporate state is a cartelizing device, how come the antitrust law is even kept in a formal sense? Because that seems to be an opposition to it. What I'm saying is, I think Forrest hinted at that this morning also, is that the Antitrust Act becomes a device, not an anti-business device per se, but a device by which one businessman or groups of businessmen clobber the other group, competing group. In other words, it's a device used by one set of businessmen to engage in monopolistic privileges or subsidies and to cripple the competition. We see now, of course, this is done all the time, even openly. We have these private antitrust suits where, for example, a recent IBM case, where IBM's suit has been brought against IBM on the antitrust division as a monopoly. This case was brought by the Control Data Corporation, a competing computer outfit, and other ally computer outfits, an obvious attempt to cripple a large and successful competitor. And Lowell Mason, in his great book, The Language of Dissent, I think it was called, is talking about his experiences with the Federal Trade Commission as a constant one-man laissez-faire minority. The Federal Trade Commission in the 50s and 60s, I think it was, keeps talking about all these cases, and most of these cases are brought by competing businessmen who want to clobber their successful opposition. They don't like the fact this guy's having rebates, this guy has this, that, and the other thing. So outlaw it. Stop it. What I'm saying here is that the Teddy Roosevelt launching a modern antitrust policy, so to speak, is part of the same pattern, except on a larger scale. Because, as far as says, Teddy Roosevelt was not a trust buster. But what he did is, it seems to me, he tried to bust and did successfully bust one trust. That trust happened to be Standard Oil Company in New Jersey. So in other words, we break this sort of fairly happy situation, peaceful coexistence, in the business world, politically, is suddenly ruptured by a savage attack launched on Standard Oil by Teddy Roosevelt. Why did he do it? I feel on firm ground by saying that this is what he did. This is essentially a Morgan attack on Rockefeller, opening up a great titanic struggle for quite some time between the Morgan interests and the Rockefeller interests, which I feel goes down for many years thereafter. Why was this launch? I don't know. I can really be very speculative. I don't think too much has been done on this. let me say, it seems to me not purely a coincidence, but around this time, around it was the early 1900s, we begin to have a titanic struggle on a worldwide scale for international oil markets and international oil investments and oil concessions between Standard Oil Company in New Jersey on one hand, Rockefeller interest on one hand, and Royal Dutch Shell on the other. Royal Dutch Shell was a fusion between the British Shell Transport and Trading Company and the Royal Dutch Company, and which were existing before 1907, then they were merged formally in 1907, which was essentially a giant organization fueled and in the ambit of the famous and extremely powerful Rothschild interests. So we have essentially the Rothschild interests with this Royal Dutch Shell on the one hand and the Standard Oil and Rockefeller interests on the other, waging a fantastic struggle beginning around this period and continuing on for a long time, at least as late as in the late 1920s. This seems to us to be almost inconceivable. You really have to sort of pinch yourself to really believe it. Several books were written by reputable journalists around 1929 and 1930, actually predicting war between the United States and Britain, I mean physical war, military conflict, because of this great oil struggle, Standard Oil versus Royal Dutch Shell struggle. Now, what I am speculating is that the Morgan attack, the Morgan-Teddy Roosevelt blistering attack on Standard Oil to break it up, might have had something to do with the Rothschild-Royal Dutch Shell war with Standard Oil on the international front. In other words, what I'm postulating is essentially a Morgan-Rothschild tie-in, at least to this extent. At any rate, Teddy Roosevelt launches this blistering attack on the Rockefellers. The Morgans are very happy with Teddy Roosevelt, of course, throughout. When Teddy Roosevelt runs for re-election, the Morgans and everybody in their ambit, you know, boost him and so forth, give money to his campaign, and they're very happy with the whole situation. Poor old Rockefeller, of course, was not very happy. And Rockefeller broke his long-standing ties to the Republican Party, at least for one campaign, to support poor old Judge Alton H. Parker, the Democratic candidate for president in 1904. Judge Parker was hardly a good competitor with Teddy Roosevelt's charismatic style, etc., and was clobbered. What we have is the Morgans, I think, much stronger than the Rockefellers in pushing the National Civic Federation kind of thing, the Perkins and the PC and all that. As I think I sort of mentioned in passing, the Rockefeller wasn't very happy with the entry into World War I, just about the only large business corporate leader who was at least benevolently not neutral, or malevolently neutral to the idea of intervention. What then with Taft? Well, through some kind of fluke, Elihu Root, the designated successor of Teddy Roosevelt, is not the designated successor, William Howard Taft takes over. William Howard Taft, I postulate, was essentially a Rockefeller person, being an Ohio Republican, and starts launching a huge antitrust campaign against whom? He launches an antitrust campaign against two giant Morgan companies, his biggest antitrust campaign, United States Steel Corporation and International Harvester. So I interpret the Taft antitrust campaigns is not only a sort of legalistic dum-dum legalism, but also the great Rockefeller revenge against the Morgans. In other words, using antitrust, saying, okay, you did this to me, I'm going to smash you, boy, and lashing out, perfectly reasonable, understandable, it's an approach. when Teddy Roosevelt started objecting very vociferously, in other words, the split of big business with Taft comes as soon as he starts launching these attacks on U.S. Steel International Harvester. Taft, in kind of a dumb way, I must admit, accuses Teddy Roosevelt of selling out the Morgan and the Steel Trust because Teddy Roosevelt is opposing this antitrust action. Presumably he should have known that Teddy Roosevelt sold out a long time ago. At any rate, Taft, in launching this attack on International Harvester, denounces this Teddy Roosevelt-Morgan alliance. So comes the 1912 campaign. Taft had one term in office, and What is the reaction? Of course, as Forrest mentioned this morning, the usual interpretation of the historians is that Taft is a terrible, Teddy Roosevelt is a great liberal progressive, and Taft is this horrible big business reactionary. Who supports Taft for re-election? Not big business, that's for sure. It's not only that they don't support Taft re-election, they launch a new party. I mean, this is a big headache. You can launch a new party on a nationwide scale. It costs a lot of money, it costs a lot of energy. They launch a new party, the Progressive Party, for the express purpose of smashing William Howard Taft, sending him back to the showers, and ensuring the re-election of Woodrow Wilson. Big business in the Morgan ambit, particularly, was very enthusiastic about the Teddy Roosevelt campaigns, this great progressive campaign in 1912. George W. Perkins, of course, was the head of the whole Progressive Party, Morgan partner. Frank Munsey, newspaper publisher of the Morgan ambit, was another big shot in the Teddy Roosevelt campaign. Also, lots of McCormicks, a whole bunch of McCormick people in the McCormick family. Judge Gary, naturally. And we have in the Progressive Party, the leadership of the Progressive Party, an enormous number of large businessmen, corporate lawyers, a few professors and editors. And the big business support, on the other hand, for William Howard Taft is almost nil. He has, of course, the Republican Party machine. And he's our president. We re-elect him. A normal response. And just about the only big businessmen who were for Taft were Elihu Root, who was disgruntled because Roosevelt had not selected him to be a successor, and Senator Nelson W. Aldrich in the Rockefeller ambit. So, and Aldrich, of course, running by this time the party machinery. Poor old Rockefeller had been boosting Mark Hanna for the presidency as against Teddy Roosevelt before Taft was elected. And Mark Hanna died. There was no later candidate. So we have a campaign where Taft had virtually no support among big business leadership. Some of the interesting things about the Progressive Party in 1912, Teddy Roosevelt was backed by 90% of the Union League Club of Chicago. I keep returning you that. George W. Perkins, of course, as we'll see, was very much ardently in favor of a federal ICC, federal trade type commission. And Frank Munsey, the newspaper publisher, had invested very heavily personally in U.S. Steel and International Harvester and other Morgan companies. Two-thirds of the leadership of the Progressive Party, according to Coco, were big businessmen and corporate lawyers. And generally, there's a very high concentration of upper-class urban WASP Republicans, white Anglo-Saxon Republicans. Teddy Roosevelt calls during the campaign for a national industrial commission similar to the ICC. This theme, of course, pops up continually now. To do for big business in general what the ICC did for the railroads, not to the railroads, but for them. To prevent overcapitalization, in other words, to restrict competition. Progressive Party platform demands strong national regulation of corporations, a federal commission similar to the ICC to attack what? To attack unfair competition. And whenever businessmen talk about unfair competition, what they mean is, quote, what they mean is effective competition. In other words, you can cross out the unfair, put in the effective. Sort of the Orwell newspeak. Progressive Party platform said, quote, with this new kind of federal trade commission, the businessmen will have certain knowledge of the law, the investor will find security for his capital, dividends will be rendered more certain. Under such a system of constructive regulation, legitimate business, freed from confusion, uncertainty, and fruitless litigation, will develop normally. Progressive Party cited Germany openly as the ideal example. For in Germany, quote, their policy of cooperation between government and business has in comparatively few years made them a leading competitor for the commerce of the world, unquote, end quote. The time has come when the federal government should cooperate with manufacturers and producers in extending our foreign commerce, unquote. The Republican Party platform also called for a federal trade commission with considerably less enthusiasm and less detail. Okay, the Morgans have their revenge for this aberration of William Howard Taft. Taft is smashed, just incredible clobbering of a major party presidential candidate. We have the election of the good gray Woodrow Wilson, who sort of ranks, in my view, somewhere along with Rex Tugwell, except he's more important to Rex Tugwell than my cast of favorites. Wilson, of course, has always been held up as an anti-business and by storing an anti-business progressive, as far as says, Jeffersonian type. Who were his main sponsors in this? Well, they weren't as illustrious, I will admit, as the sponsors of Teddy Roosevelt. But they cut a pretty good swath. For example, there was his classmate, Cleveland Dodge, a very important magnate in copper and various other things. There was Cyrus H. McCormick, who was an old pal of Woodrow Wilson. There was George W. Harvey, president of Harper Brothers and Harper's Weekly, great publishers, which was essentially controlled by Morgan and the Morgan ambit. Thomas Fortune Ryan was heavily involved here, and we come to his, fortuitously around this time, we have his new son-in-law, William Gibbs McAdoo, who comes very important from now through the 20s, who was a longtime associate of the Ryan interests in New York City utilities, and again, at least a Morgan ally. McAdoo has a strange career after the war. During the war, he's extremely important. Also in favor of Wilson in 1912 was Jacob Schiff, Hugh Loeb and Company, Henry Lee Higginson, the great Boston magnate. Cleveland Dodge, by the way, was associated with National City Bank of New York, and Bernard M. Baruch, as mentioned before, I'll mention again, David B. Jones and Thomas Jones of International Harvester Company, which is essentially Morgan. Henry Seligman of Wall Street, of the bank, international banking firm, and J.P. Morgan, when Wilson was elected, J.P. Morgan writes to somebody and says, expresses his great friendship and so forth with Woodrow Wilson. Wilson's a very sound fellow. So it seems to me here we have a great ploy where the big business magnates, originally and usually a Republican, band together to smash this anti-Morgan upstart and pack him away and ensure the election of Wilson. Wilson, quite early, I think it's interesting that Wilson was the first great professor to become president. That should be a warning to all of us. He was, in 1912, in the campaign, expressed himself in favor of government regulation of reasonable competition and reasonable combination, which doesn't say very much. And his most precise speech, his fullest speech on the subject of business regulation during the campaign, he came out in favor of the government preventing price fixing and control of raw materials and what? And our old friends, cutthroat competition. In this case, cutthroat is the same as unfair, i.e. effective. Against cutthroat competition and overcapitalization, which means he's in favor of the government cartelizing the system so as to restrict production and keep competition moderate, so to speak. These are very similar views, very similar views to what Perkins has been advocating for quite some time. After the election, Professor Jeremiah W. Jenks of the National Civic Federation, distinguished economist at this current university, a big budding corporatist, says, well, now that the campaign is over, Woodrow Wilson is elected, we should get on with the constructive work of stabilizing the system, which is really sort of a forecast of things to come. Well, the COCO has this section of material on the origins of the Federal Trade Commission, which I'll sort of summarize a bit here. As early as 1908, two people have been pushing the idea of a Federal Trade Commission or Interstate Trade Commission. Francis Lynn Stetson, who I mentioned before, is J.P. Morgan's personal attorney, and Victor Morowitz, Bill Beach's pal, a railroad attorney for Morgan Railroads. They drafted the bill called the Hepburn Bill. I mentioned the Hepburn Bill. I want to be sure Ken Teppel, this is not the Hepburn Act, in which he's a specialist on railroads. This is the Hepburn Bill for Federal Trade Commission. to allow the bill to allow corporations to register with the federal government and to be informed whether the proposed any proposed action is or merger is legal or illegal. And and this Stetson and Morowitz were aided in their effort by Judge Gary, George W. Perkins, Isaac Seligman, Augustus Belmont, Samuel Gompers, Jeremiah W. Jenks, and J.P. Morgan himself participated in this effort. But Teddy Roosevelt, interestingly enough, turned it down, even though it was a Morgan proposal. He turned it down for an interesting reason, because it was too pro-union. Because, interesting, alleged great progressive. Because one of the proposals was to exempt the unions from the Sherman Act. And so the bill goes into abeyance for a while. And under Taft, of course, the whole thing, the whole Morgan ambit disappears. We have to wait until Wilson becomes president. Meantime, one of the most interesting people in this whole group is Arthur J. Eddy, Chicago corporation lawyer, who was one of the great theoreticians of trade associations, eliminating unfair competition, or competition period, creating cartels, allocating markets, allocating quotas for each firm, fixing prices, in other words, raising prices, and so forth. In 1912, Eddy wrote a very important book called The New Competition, sort of the manifesto of this movement, where, as I said before, I think, competition, he says competition is war, because he blazons this all throughout the book in italics. Competition is war. War is hell, and therefore we should, end competition, more or less. He wanted to repeal the Sherman Act outright and to pass a federal licensing law for corporations, enact the Federal Trade Commission to govern trade associations, to enforce price and market agreements by industrial self-government, that is, to enforce cartel agreements to raise prices and restrict production. It's a very detailed outline of a corporate state kind of setup. And interestingly enough, he uses sort of what we often would consider to be left-wing altruist rhetoric. In other words, he says competition is selfish, and we should therefore restrict it in favor of the altruistic world of cooperation. And cooperation is sort of the other word, the code word for, of course, for cartelization. Competition, he refers to as inhuman and piratic and destructive to stable prices, in other words, destructive to high prices. Quote from Eddy, competition free and unfettered is absolutely destructive to all stability of prices. Before the interstate commerce law, see, for the railroads, regulating railway rates, competition reigned. To a certain extent, the railroads from time to time cooperated to control conditions by pools and associations, but not until the government stepped in and called a halt to vicious competition where rates regulated in any permanent manner, which is sets forth the so-called Coco thesis of the function of the Interstate Commerce Commission. And then he adds that he says he wants legislation. He adds in a letter, he says something. He says he wants legislation at least as effective for general industry as the ICC was for the railroads. He also, in the course of the book, hailed this, what he called the more philosophical socialists. By this he meant the right wing socialists, the Bernstein types, and in the United States the more conservative socialists. Who would surface during the Wilson administration later, who were in favor of the trust as a forerunner of socialism. We have the trust. The trust is great because all we have to do is have the government take it over and it'll be socialism. So he was in favor of these guys because they were in favor of what he was in favor of, at least for the short run. And he says, interestingly enough, that the only class in the country that benefits from free competition are the non-producers who have fixed incomes. They want low prices. It's kind of interesting statement because I thought that all consumers want low pricing. Consumers is everybody, but he didn't look at it that way, or chose not to look at it that way. When in his 1915 edition of the book, the book came out originally in 1912, the 1915 edition, Eddy hailed the new Federal Trade Commission. He well might have because he was one of the people who contributed to writing it. Hails the new Federal Trade Act, especially Section 5, which outlawed, quote, unfair methods of competition, unquote. And he says this will lead to uniform prices, will end the reign of cutthroat competition, and will lead to things like fair trade or resale price maintenance, which comes in, of course, later in force. Um, when the Federal Trade Commission is finally passed, it turns out that one of the very few people attacking it on individualist grounds was Senator Borah, who was probably one of the very few, at least outstanding, individualist progressives. And Wilson's message, 1914 message to Congress, calls for something like a Federal Trade Commission, says, you know, which will ensure no further antagonism between government and business. And generally, most business groups hailed and lauded the idea of the Federal Trade Commission, including the Chicago Association of Commerce and the National U.S. Chamber of Commerce. One of the people especially enthusiastic about this was Thomas Cray, who was the attorney for Cudahy Meatpacking Company. One of the few business groups that really strongly opposed the Federal Trade Commission was the New York State Chamber of Commerce and the Philadelphia Bourse. The NAM was split, uncertain, divided, didn't really take any strong stand one way or the other. Comes the Federal Trade Commission, as Coco points out. The law was vague enough. The law outlawing unfair competition, the Clayton Act, which comes along with it, outlawing price discrimination, which gets into our rebate, the general rebate question. The law was vague enough, of course, to have the composition of the Federal Trade Commission be very important. Who's going to be on it? Who's going to be interpreting this? It's rather vague, if hopeful document from the corporatist point of view. The chairman, the head of the Federal Trade Commission, the first head of it, is Joseph E. Davies, a corporation lawyer who had been head of the Bureau of Corporations, which Forrest has mentioned. And Joseph E. Davies pops up much later in American foreign policy as ambassador of Soviet Russia and the author of the famous book Mission to Moscow. This is much, much later, for which he was attacked by the right wing as being a communist. I don't think that his general outlook changed much from one decade to another. These are different conditions. At any rate, so he was the head of the Federal Trade Commission. Thomas Cray, whom I mentioned before, from Cudahy, was a member of it. Another member was George Rubley, who was a corporation lawyer, and one of the major drafters of the bill, and Gilbert Montague of the Merchants Association of New York. Federal Trade Commission has set outlawed unfair competition and the Clayton Act price discrimination. And also in the Clayton Act, it said unions were not illegal. It didn't exactly exempt unions from the Antitrust Act, but it was sort of step in that direction. And it was felt that the Clayton Act would make it possible for trade associations to voluntarily stabilize prices and not be harassed for that. Again, hailing the act, in addition to the people I mentioned, was Samuel Gompers, the American Federation of Labor. Of course, this fits right in with their point of view. Francis Lynn Stetson, who was one of course, the Morgan lawyer, is one of the original theoreticians of all this. Arthur J. Eddy, I've mentioned. And comes the commission, as I say, these were not the Federal Trade Commission. I got this all up. These were some of the people favoring, pushing it. Montague, Rubley, Cray, etc. The Federal Trade Commission comes in, and Joe Davies was the chairman. Vice chairman was a key figure in the commission, was Edward N. Hurley of Chicago, was a manufacturer in Illinois, president of the Illinois Manufacturers Association, and one of the founders of the pneumatic tool industry. Rubley was on it. was nominated by the Chicago Association of Commerce, also had been a lawyer and a member of the Progressive, leader of the Progressive Party, also big in the United States Chamber of Commerce. Also on it were Will Parry, a shipbuilder, and William Harris, a Georgia businessman. These were the commissioners. Also Secretary of Commerce during the Wilson administration was a very important figure, William C. Redfield, who had formerly been president of the American Manufacturers Export Association, as a New York iron and steel manufacturer and a long-time advocate of corporatist, you know, business-government cooperation kind of system, especially in foreign trade, and also a long-time advocate of encouraging trade associations. Davies, in working out the guidelines and the specific details for the Federal Trade Commission, is aided and abetted by Arthur J. Eddy, again, who's right in there, hip-deep, Booker D. Hines, railroad executive, becomes important later on, and Victor Morowitz, our old friend of the railroad attorney, and C.R. Van Hise of U.S. Chamber of Commerce. business was generally highly enthused about the whole thing. It was enthused about the appointments and about the war now. Wilson said this was helping business. This was a great thing. Davy says, there's, quote, there's a great opportunity for this new agency and government to be a practical aid to the business of this country. That is indeed one of the purposes for which it was created. Well, Davies pretty soon shifts to the foreign affairs, after about a year or so, shifts to the great task of preparing for the war with Germany. And this leaves Hurley as the sort of the key figure in the Federal Trade Commission. Hurley is beloved, and it comes with Coco describes a great love affair between the organized business and then Hurley. Hurley, for example, told the Association of National Advertisers in December 1915, quote, through a period of years, the government has been gradually extending its machinery of helpfulness. Then he mentions the railroads have, the shippers have the ICC, the bankers have the Federal Reserve System, which we're getting to. The farmers have the Department of Agriculture, and now, quote, to do for general business that which these other agencies do for the groups to which I have referred was the thought behind the creation of the Federal Trade Commission, unquote. Wilson read this and fully supported this interpretation of the origins and nature of the Federal Trade Commission. As a matter of fact, we got one of these things which pops up a lot. It might have popped up earlier in American history, but I just gloomed onto this here. Hurley, for example, by 1916 is grafting Wilson's speech praising Hurley and Hurley's actions in the Federal Trade Commission. Hoover did a lot of this later on. So he's drafting stuff of Wilson to praise what a great guy Hoover is. And Hurley tells the National Industrial Conference Board in July 1916, quote, I do not know anything about the law, and that applies to the Clayton Act and the Federal Trade Commission Act. In my position on the Federal Trade Commission, I'm there as a businessman. When I was offered the place, I told the president that all I knew was business, that I knew nothing about the new laws or the old ones, that I would apply the force that I might have in the interest of business. I think that the businessmen of this country will bear me out when I say that I try to work wholly in the interest of business, which, of course, is great applause. The Federal Trade Commission is now pushing also directly for, shortly after it gets started, for cartels, for price fixing, for especially for export trade associations, for foreign competition. It was one of the major forces behind the Webb-Pomeroy Act of April 1918, which allowed export trade associations, gave essentially the federal government imprimatur behind them. And Wilson put it, the Federal Trade in 1916, the Federal Trade Commission has transformed the government of the United States from being an antagonist of business into being a friend of business. As Coco says, it's a little bit of exaggeration because they weren't really an antagonist of business before that anyway, but this is the way Wilson chose to see it.